Today we're in Matthew chapter 16. So if you have your Bible, go ahead and open up to Matthew chapter 16. Last week, we looked at a section where we saw Jesus calling his first disciples. And he is going through Galilee preaching. He called people to action, right? We saw that last week. He called them to repent for the kingdom of heaven. And what did we say that is? The kingdom of heaven is the rule of God, right? The reign of God. He said the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And we saw how he called common fishermen to follow him. And he told them that he was going to make them into something. He was going to do something with them, right? He was going to transform them. He was going to make them into people who could catch people. Their goal would be to bring people to him and ultimately to Jesus' Father in heaven. So as we read through Matthew, man, if you keep going, there's so much cool stuff in there. There's so much neat information in there. I challenge you to read through the gospel. Read through this particular telling of the good news of Jesus. But today we're jumping to 16. And the reason being is we're actually following a theme. Okay, we're following a theme in the life of Jesus and in the ministry of Jesus. We saw his baptism. We saw what that meant. We saw heaven open up. We saw Jesus being declared the Son of God. We saw the Holy Spirit descend on Jesus. Right after that, Jesus goes out into the wilderness to fast and pray. He goes out to prepare for his ministry. And while he's out in the wilderness, Jesus is attacked, right? Scripture says he's tested, but we know what the motive of the devil was, right? It was to destroy. So it is a spiritual attack. The adversary is attempting to derail what Father God has planned for Jesus. He is trying to push the right buttons. He believes he can cause Jesus to go against the Father's will. Well, as we read that, we saw that Jesus not only withstood the test, but in doing so, he also set an example for us how we can withstand trials, right? Because what did he do? Some of the Norwood coming out of me. That's where I grew up. What did he do? He showed a reliance on the will of God, on the Word of God, and on the Spirit of God. And he comes out of that intense time of spiritual warfare, and he calls people to repent. He calls people to change. He calls people to follow him. Why? Because he is bringing with him another kingdom. Amen? Amen. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven. A kingdom that will challenge the kingdoms of the world. So today in our section, it's interesting where Jesus takes his disciples. They go to Caesarea Philippi. Why Caesarea Philippi? It's this town that is not even in Judea, by the way. It's not even in Galilee. Jesus takes them way north into an entirely other region. And so the question here is why? Why would he take them here? Well, here's a little bit of information about the region. Caesarea Philippi is a region whose ancient name was Bashan. When Moses brought the people out of Egypt, they fought and they killed the king of Bashan. He was a giant named Og. And it's at the base of a mountain. The mountain's name is Mount Hermon. And a short explanation of this. If you think of Mount Sinai in Arabia, you think of Mount Zion, what do you think of? You think of the mountain of God, right? Well, Mount Hermon would be the exact opposite. From the first century Jewish perspective, Mount Hermon was the mountain home of the adversary. They believed at one point prior to the flood of Noah, 200 angels rebelled against God and descended on Mount Hermon. There had been revivals on and off of calf worship in Bashan during certain periods of history. Caesarea Philippi was the location of the shrine of the pagan god Pan. So, Caesarea Philippi, Bashan, Mount Hermon, what are they? They are the territory of the enemy, right? This is enemy ground. This is enemy territory. We're talking spiritual warfare here. Even later on, do y'all remember when you're reading about Jesus' crucifixion and Jesus actually quotes scripture? Did you know that? He quotes scripture during his crucifixion, Matthew 27:46. My God, you know this, right? My God, why have you forsaken me? Most people don't realize he's quoting scripture there. He's quoting from Psalm 22. Jesus on the cross is actually quoting King David. Listen to the way that psalm goes. Psalm 22, it says this. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. To you they trusted and they were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man. I'm scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me, and they make mouths at me, and they wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let the Lord deliver him. Let him rescue him. For he delights in him. He delights in the Lord. Yet ye are he who took me from the womb and made me trust in you. At my mother's breasts, on you I was cast from birth, and from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near and there is no help. Many bulls encompass me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like raving and roaring lions. So what is he saying there? What's David saying there? What's Jesus saying by quoting that scripture? The false gods worshipped up in Bashan, the bulls of Bashan, the enemies of God, what are they doing? The demonic forces, this is all spiritual warfare here. It's Jesus against the devil. It's the promise of Abraham and the root of David against the bulls of Bashan, right? And so here in Matthew 16, just like the devil brought the battle to Jesus in the wilderness, right? Because that's what he did. Just like the devil brought the battle to Jesus in the wilderness, what is Jesus doing in Matthew 16? Jesus is taking the battle to the devil right there at the foot of Mount Hermon. At his baptism, Jesus is declared to be the Son of God. The temptations that he fought in the wilderness are all related to that pronouncement. And this is how Matthew 16 goes. Now, when Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? Did you get the continuing theme there? He looks at those men who had followed him. They spent years with him at this point, and he takes them onto enemy soil, and he's standing there, and he says, who do people say I am? Verse 14 and 15, and they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say
I am? Who do you say I am?
And this is a big question, isn't it? Because now once you answer this question, man, it's life-changing. Once you answer this question, it clarifies life for you. Who is Jesus? Let me ask you this morning. Who is Jesus? Verse 16, Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." By the way, that's the right answer. Jesus is the Christ. The word there is the same as the Hebrew word Messiah. Well, what was the Messiah? The Messiah is the coming king who would reign and also save his people. He would be a righteous ruler. He would defeat his enemies. And Peter is saying, "You are Messiah." It goes on, and Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." What Jesus is saying here is that his kingdom is based on the pronouncement that was made all the way back there in chapter 4 by the Father. Who'd the Father say he was? And that information now, who's agreeing with that? Peter, right? The Father said it at Jesus' baptism. Peter just echoed what the Father said. And the kingdom of Jesus, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God is based upon the identity of Jesus. There are those who want to take this section and make it all about Peter. It's not. It's not all about Peter. That interpretation of Scripture came about when they were trying to find scriptural authority for the role of the Pope. Okay? That interpretation of those verses came about during that time period. The verse is not saying Peter is the foundation of the church. And there's even some humor here in these verses. Because in the original language, it's kind of like this. "Peter, you are a stone. But on this boulder, I will build my church." That's what it says, right? You are a little rock. But upon this boulder, upon this big rock, upon this bedrock, I will build my church. The boulder is the truth about who Jesus is. The bedrock fact is that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is the Messiah. Then Jesus makes this very clear statement about the war. Because remember, we're talking war, aren't we? We're talking spiritual warfare here. And he makes a very clear statement. Standing there on enemy ground, Jesus says that his kingdom, the church, will break the defenses of the enemy. Jesus and his kingdom are the ones on the attack. Do you realize that when you read it? Jesus and his kingdom are the ones on the attack. They're attacking the enemy. Jesus says the enemy will not be able to withstand your attacks. Christians, what is your position? Are you on the defensive? Or are you on the offensive? Are you playing defense or you playing offense? Because Jesus says his church attacks hell. Right? His church is attacking the kingdom of the evil one, and they cannot win. The evil one cannot win. And it goes right into this next statement. He says in 19 and following, he says, "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." I'll admit to you, man, for a long time I struggled with the meaning of that. And here's what I've come to. What is the significance of keys? Somebody share with me. What's the significance of keys? All right. All good answers. All good answers. I wrote down some things. See if you agree with these. Keys are access. You agree with that? Keys are authority. Keys are responsibility. And keys are trust. Do you agree with those four things? Might mean more than that, but at least it's those four things, right? And I don't believe this statement is exclusive to Peter either, because just a few chapters later in Matthew, this whole language, this whole binding and loosing language, who is it used for? It's used for the church as they're dealing with sins of people, right? He uses the statement again later on when he's talking about the church. I believe this is talking about the responsibility of the Jesus follower. We have been given access to the kingdom of God. Anybody thankful for that? Amen. Say amen. We have been given access to the kingdom of God. And not only that, but we have given the means to allow others access to the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
And those to whom you share the gospel with and they accept it, guess what will happen? Those to whom you share the gospel of Jesus with and they accept it, guess what will happen? They will be allowed admittance. And those you withhold it from? Ouch. You ever think about that? I know that's kind of harsh, thinking about us withholding the gospel from people, but that's what we're doing when we don't share it. Right? That's what we're doing. We're withholding. In John's gospel, he says something similar. He says, in John's gospel, Jesus says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. What is he talking about there? And you go, I can't forgive someone's sins. But you know what you can do? You can connect that person to someone who can. Right? And if you don't connect them with the person who can, what are you doing? You're withholding forgiveness. Right? And so I believe what Jesus is doing here is emphasizing the responsibility of those who belong to him. It is your charge, Christian. It is your charge to advance the kingdom of God. We have the keys. And what you do here will have eternal repercussions. It will be binding. We will bind. What we bind here will be bound in heaven, and what we loose here will be loosed in heaven. And Jesus has already won this spiritual war. The next two sections, here's kind of what he's driving home. These are the points he's driving home. Like in 21 through 23, Jesus fills his disciples in on the fact that this is going to include his death, burial, and resurrection, right? That's what we're going to be talking about in a couple weeks. Death, burial, and resurrection. Well, he lets those guys in on that. And Peter, the guy who just made the confession, Peter, the guy who just agreed with the Father, the guy who echoed the words of the Father just a few verses earlier, is now echoing someone else's words. When Jesus shares about what's coming, Peter says, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. In other words, what is he saying? If you're the Son of God, or since you're the Son of God, they can't do this to you. They can't do this because you're the Son of God. And Peter, in this moment, what is he doing to Jesus? Peter, in this moment, is tempting Jesus the very same way he was tempted in the wilderness by Satan. Right? And how does Jesus respond to him? Get behind me, Satan. Just a few verses earlier, you and the Father, same page. Now Peter's like, Peter, dude. Chill. You're a hindrance to me, he says. For you're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. And remember, the entire life of Jesus was about what? The entire life of Jesus was about following the plan of God instead of his own flesh, right?
And he clearly shows us two paths here. There are two ways to proceed. He can follow the world. He can follow his flesh. He can handle things the way that mankind handles things. Or he can follow Father God. And that's why Jesus then says to his disciples, and I'll warn you before we go on to this next section, right? If a challenge or a call to action makes you uncomfortable, just tune out for a couple minutes, right? We'll wake you up later, right, before we leave. Because this is going to be hard. This is a hard teaching. And Jesus is not being figurative here. Jesus is being literal here. If anyone would come after me. So what is he saying? If you're going to be a follower of Jesus? If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? What is he telling his followers? Life is more than this world. Life is something that continues. After our bodies give out, we will still continue to live. And Jesus is calling his disciples to remember that, to live life while they're in the body, to live life in the body, even with an eternal perspective, right? Jesus took up his cross. It was him selflessly being our servant. It was him prioritizing the kingdom of God over the kingdoms of the world. We saw that. And he says to his disciples, you have to do this too. You have to do this as well. There will be those who do not do this, and there will be those who do this. That's why he reminds them, he goes on to say, for the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father. And then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Wow. And we like to think that he's just talking about those who don't know Jesus being judged according to what they've done. But that's not the context here. That's not what he's saying. It's a warning to those who are his followers to pick up their crosses. It's a warning to those who are his followers to live sacrificially for the kingdom of God. And what Jesus is saying is that the Father knows whether you're doing that or whether you're not doing that, and the day is coming when all of that is going to be brought to light. And everybody got still. The next section is one that's hotly debated. He says this, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. I don't think this is talking about the second coming. I believe it's talking about Pentecost. I believe it's talking about the birthday of the church. Because why is that significant? The Holy Spirit came in power. And then what did the church do? The church began advancing on the kingdom of hell. Amen? The church, the kingdom of God, began advancing upon the kingdom of hell. The spiritual battle that would change the entire world began. And today, we all need to answer which side of that battle are you on? Which kingdom are you a part of? Are you a part of the kingdom of God? Are you part of the kingdoms of the world? You got to answer the question, who is Jesus? Because if you believe he is the Christ, if you believe he is the Messiah, if you believe he is the Savior and the King, you have to commit to serving the Father the way he did, by living sacrificially in service of God's kingdom. And then he hands you the keys so you can go out and admit as many as you can.
Amen.
This morning we're going to sing a song of decision. If you want to make that decision for the Lord this morning, you come forward as we sing this song.